Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Moth and the Mountain, a true story of love, war, and Everest by Ed Caesar. Read by James Langton.
For my mother, Janie Caesar, and in memory of my father, Lieutenant Commander Ben Caesar, Royal Navy, 1938 to 1982. Have we vanquished an enemy? None but ourselves. Have we gained success? That word means nothing here. Have we won a kingdom? No. And yes, we have achieved an ultimate satisfaction, fulfilled a destiny. To struggle and to understand, never this last without the other, such is the law. George Mallory, Mont Blanc from the Col de Géant by the Eastern Buttress, Alpine Journal, 1918. Then, with many other men, he was transported in a cattle truck to the scene of war. For a while, chance was kind, save for an inevitable searing of the mind. Herbert Reed, Nishaw Goes to War, 1918. Keep Smiling. Morris Wilson, Letter to Enid Evans, 1933. Prologue. The World Will Be on Fire. March 20th to April 10th, 1934. Before he began his trek to Mount Everest, Morris Wilson changed into a magnificent costume. He was 35 years old. The fine blonde hair of his youth had run to silver and thinned to a widow's peak. Two or three machine gun scars blotted the skin on his left arm and back, like pitch marks on a golf green. His arm still ached every day. So did his knees, the legacy of an inexpert parachute jump made more than a year earlier. Nevertheless, he was fit, strong, and rail thin after months of training, intermittent fasting, and long periods of sober living. Wilson was not a handsome man, not exactly. The features were too pronounced, the picture was hung a little askew. But even in his current unkempt state, when a scruffy new beard carpeted his usually smooth cheeks, he was beguiling. Many women had fallen hard for Wilson's blue-green eyes, and his boyish grin, and his percussive Yorkshire accent, with its sonorous vowels and dropped H's. He was unlike other men. He was difficult to ignore. Night had fallen. Wilson dressed in his hotel room in the hill town of Darjeeling, which lay in the northeast of Britain's vast Indian Empire. In a few hours, Wilson would start to walk more than 300 miles to the north side of Everest in Tibet. He then planned to climb the mountain alone, and in doing so, to become the first person ever to reach its summit, the highest place on earth. The idea was mad, any way you looked at it. No climber from four separate official British expeditions, the first in 1921, and the latest only the previous year in 1933, had reached the summit of Everest. Those parties comprised the best alpinists of their generation, and were supported by teams of porters carrying bountiful supplies. The odds of a novice, such as Wilson, succeeding where those missions had failed were vanishingly long, as every pundit had told him. But Wilson was not interested in expert opinion, otherwise he would have turned back long ago. He was interested in the power of human will and the motions of the soul. Everest was a job he felt was within him. Wilson had been expressly forbidden by the British authorities, both in India and at home in England, to make the journey. The Tibetan government had not given him permission to enter their kingdom, and the British were anxious to avoid a diplomatic incident. If Wilson was discovered at any point on his trek, he would be arrested. He knew he was in most danger of apprehension on the first part of his journey, out of Darjeeling, and through the British protectorate of Sikkim, with its leech-infested rivers, verdant forests, and sparkling waterfalls. For that reason, he had paid his hotel bill 6 months in advance to throw the police off the scent. He also planned to leave Darjeeling at midnight in disguise as a Tibetan priest. Wilson had hired 3 bhutias, Sikkimese men of Tibetan ancestry, to accompany him to Everest. The most senior of them, an experienced climber and porter named Tsering, helped him into his outfit. The disguise was dazzling. A Chinese brocaded waistcoat in gold, with gold buttons at the side, which Wilson thought made him look like a circus trainer. Dark blue cotton slacks, a bright red silk girdle. To finish the look, Wilson wore a fur-lined bhutia hat with large ear flaps to cover his white man's hair, dark glasses to hide his white man's eyes, and he carried a decorative umbrella. Somewhat ruining the effect, he also wore a pair of hobnail boots, huge, high, heavy items with nails driven into the soles for extra grip. A ludicrous outfit. Wilson loved it. He and Tsering had laughed themselves silly when Wilson first tried on the disguise. Before Wilson left the hotel, he wrote a final letter to Enid Evans, his soulmate, and the only person who believed from the very beginning of the adventure that Wilson would succeed in reaching and climbing Everest. Enid was slim, winsome, brown-haired, stylish, vivacious, and married. Wilson was cripplingly in love with her, and not just because of her faith in his mission. She, too, was enraptured by the ebullient adventurer and his wild stories. Recently, their affair had flourished in letters. Now, Wilson was leaving Darjeeling. With no more opportunities to send mail before his climb on Everest, he wrote to Enid for a final time, telling her about his beautiful, absurd outfit and about when he might return from the mountain. He wrote that she would be with him, in his thoughts, the whole way. Before he signed off, he told Enid, if she were with him, I might let you kiss me. With his letter finished and addressed, Wilson made his final preparations. He carried with him much of his climbing equipment, disguised in what looked like bags of wheat. He had also sewn many pockets into his outfit. In one, he placed a small emerald green diary made in Japan, upon whose cover the words Present Time Book were embossed. His entries in the diary would eventually resemble a long and intimate letter to his lover alone. Of course, he wrote, I'm writing all this to Enid. She's been the golden rod from the start. In another pocket, he stashed a pistol to ward off brigands in Tibet. Around his neck was a gold cross with Rita engraved on one side and Amor vincit omnia on the other. Amor vincit omnia. Love conquers all. Midnight ticked around. 0 hour. Wilson left the hotel by the back door, then met Tsering on the street. The plan was to rendezvous with the other 2 bhutias, Te Wong and Rinzing, at midday in a hideout near the banks of the river Tista on the outskirts of Darjeeling. Wilson and Tsering walked out of town in the early hours of the morning without incident. As day broke, they entered the valley of the raging Tista River when, to their horror, they saw a policeman on the road. The officer spotted the pair before they could slip away. Wilson had no choice but to perform his ridiculous charade with as much confidence as he could muster. He was 5 feet 8 and a half inches tall, too big for a Tibetan. He walked with his aching knees bent to obscure his height. He then opened his umbrella, carrying it low over his face to shield his features. The policeman ordered them to stop. Tsering spoke to the officer. Wilson stood there under his umbrella, as dumb as a lamppost. All the while, he calculated his next move. If the policeman searched his belongings, he was done for. Not only were his bags full of climbing supplies and a movie camera, but there was a revolver, a priest with a gun. By some good fortune, the policeman took Wilson's silence and curious behavior to be a sign of modesty. He allowed the pair to continue up the road, unsearched. Wilson hoped his escape from Darjeeling had remained a secret. Not only had he prepaid his hotel bill, but he had sworn his Bhutia co-conspirators to silence about their joining his Everest trip. He knew that eventually his absence would be noted, but he surmised that his precautions would at the least buy him some time. Wilson and Tse Ring had plotted their clandestine trek into Tibet with the care of advancing generals. It was 300 miles of walking and climbing. Their path followed the Tista River nearly all the way through Sikkim. In Tibet, the route bisected the peaks of Kangchenjo and Chomimo, which both stood higher than 22,000 feet. It then followed the Yaru River, past the ancient, beautiful, isolated fortresses of Kambadzong and Tenkiedzong, and then across a desolate plain that looked, to Edward Shabir, a mountaineer from a previous Everest expedition, like the Mountains of the Moon. At Shekerdzong, a fairy tale place, a fortified monastery and village consisting of a crazy series of regular white buildings built into the side of a hill, the route swung south, toward the great peaks of the Himalayas, the Rongbuk Monastery, and finally into the valley that led to Everest. It was a journey from leech-filled jungle to ankle-breaking foothill, to the high desert where the air was thin and the nights were frigid, to the mountain that inhabited Wilson's dreams. Wilson's chief fear was being arrested. The previous year, the official British expedition to Everest had travelled on a similar route to the one he planned to take, with some minor variations. Unlike Wilson, they had smoothed their political problems.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.